code that can be run on different platforms, right? So the last part will be malware. So we will look at basically three topics. And the buffer overflow, we will finish maybe in just 20 minutes. So we looked at some like a definition and then some example of buffer overflow. So in the previous class, so we like provided a program, and the inside program actually we have two functions, and we can use buffer overflow to run some additional function, which is not expected to be run. However, so in reality, this kind of attack will not, basically the program will not provide the attacker the stack information, right? So the program we looked at actually will print the stack information, but in reality, this kind of stack information will be not be available to the attacker. Right, so then the attacker will need to find some other way to find the return address, and then maybe also attacker need to insert the malicious code by himself. Right, so we will look at later, we will look at some examples. So, but before we look at how like to insert the malicious code, we first look at how to prevent buffer overflow. So basically we can prevent buffer overflow from two like perspectives. So one is from developer's perspective, the other one of course is from the user perspective. So for the developer, of course, the most important job is to make sure you prevent this buffer overflow from happening. So for example, you try to avoid using this kind of a C string function, or you can simply modify this function. For example, you can create your own like string copy. You can say string copy 2. Then actually before you call the inside string copy 2, you can just check the boundary of the buffer and the input. Then before you use the string copy, basically you first do some checking. And if there is something wrong, then you can throw an exception or report some error. Right, so basically the if we can check the buffer carefully before we assign the input into the buffer, then from the developer's perspective, so we can prevent most of the buffer overflow problems. And then you can also use compiler, and actually this kind of compile like a tool used by compiler is already implemented in many compilers. For example, even like a Visual Studio, they also provide some option for you to prevent buffer overflow. So one option actually is to put a so-called like a guard value, or in Visual Studio they call it like a cookie value, right? So the cookie value or this secret cookie or the guard value is some value which is unpredictable. So basically you put some value in front of the return address, right? So this value is unpredictable by the attacker. So in this case, so you run a program, but the program will never access that particular value. So this is to detect if there is anything wrong. Basically, because code will access or modify that value, and the value is unpredictable, if later you find, okay, before you actually return the control, if you find this value is modified, that means actually that the buffer overflow must have occurred. So in this case, you can simply like abort the program instead of executing the program in the modified return address. So this is one simple way to prevent the buffer overflow by using some compiler tools. Okay, and then use some like a safe like a string function. This is another way. Of course, as I said, you can simply create your own version of the safe string function. So you basically just check the buffer, the size of the buffer before you assign the input to the buffer. Right, so from the user's perspective, so then there are also a few methods that can be used. The first method, of course, the first important note here is to avoid using some like vulnerable software. So, but this is sometimes difficult because the user may not be able to tell whether the software is vulnerable or not. But later, actually, we will see before you use software. So, actually, if you do very like a thorough or detailed testing, and actually you may be able to identify if there is any problem or vulnerability inside the software. But if say some software is optional, you don't really use the software, then it's better to avoid installing the software. So basically we should apply the default not install, similar as default deny, right? So then run the software at the least privilege required. So basically if you have some program, this program will be executed by other people. So make sure that you don't use the set UID or grant like a more privilege to other people who can execute the program, right? So in this case, even the attacker can do the buffer overflow, so they may only have a limited permission to perform some task. They may not be able to, for example, access your password, the shadow file, and so on. Right, so, and also do the update, but the update sometimes can be a problem, because nowadays, even like the Windows, sometimes when I do a update, it takes like half an hour for me to finish the update. So security perspective, it's always better that you install the latest update for software or for operating system. Right, so for some attacks, actually they come from the network. For example, the ping of DNS, right? So later actually we will see like some worms, actually they also use buffer overflow to attack the host. So in this case, if we can prevent the packet from entering to the network, then we can actually prevent this kind of buffer overflow from happening. So in the last part, we will see a particular worm. Actually, it also uses buffer overflow. So it will insert some malicious code into the buffer, and then it will change the return address to a particular address to execute the malicious code. Then the worm will send itself to different hosts, and then those four hosts will be infected, and then once the host is infected, then the host will start to infect other machines as well. So in this case, then the worm actually will spread very quickly. Right, so we will look at some example how the malware can use buffer overflow. And then testing, of course, is important. So don't just use the expected input for testing. So if the, say the, of course, when we design software, we always do like a requirement, like analysis, requirements, specification, and so on. So we have like a input format for the software. But when you do the testing, basically you need to try different types of input instead of just the expected input. And the one tool or one approach that can be used for testing is this so-called fuzzing. So fuzzing is a concept in software engineering. That means you can do automated testing. So the tool can basically generate random testing input, and then you can use the input to do the testing. So you don't need to manually generate the input. So this kind of tool actually can be used to generate different types of input, and then you can test the software using the input, and then see if there is any problem. For example, if the system will crash, or if there is some strange behavior, if you use some random input. Right, so that's basically some guidelines for preventing the buffer overflow. So next part, we will look at one particular example. So how to insert some malicious code into a buffer and then run the malicious code. Because in the example we saw yesterday, so the program is created by ourselves. So we print a stack, and then we have a program inside. We have a function inside. We try to call the function. But in reality, the attacker only have a exe file. So in this case, how to use the buffer overflow to basically do malicious actions. So we will look at one example, which is called the shellcode. So the shellcode basically will, if you have a program, then the attacker will use buffer overflow to open a shell after you finish the program. Basically, after the program is finished, then a shell will be open, because the attacker inserts some command in some program inside the buffer to open shell, and then attacker also changed the return address to that particular piece of code to open a shell, right? So in this case, so it can be a problem. If say the program has a set UID, in this case, the attacker can open a shell with the permission of the owner of the program. So this is a simple piece of code to open a shell. So if you compile this code and then you run the code, it will open a shell. So what we need to insert into the buffer is not this code. We need to insert the machine code. Because in the memory, you need to inject the machine code so that when this when the control is returned to the particular address, the machine code will be executed. So we don't insert this high-level program into the buffer. Right, so then why just open shell? Because if you remember set UID, so if say the owner of this program is a root user, and now if we can inject this malicious code, and then after you finish the execution of the program, actually you open shell, then you will have the root permission, because you will have the permission of the owner. So if the owner is a root user, then you open shell with the root permission. So although the user himself may only have very limited permission, but now this shell is open with root permission, then you can do a lot of malicious actions. Right, so this is basically the assembly code compiled from the C++ program. Right, so the assembly code essentially can be mapped to the machine code. Right, so the operations here can be mapped to machine code. So this is basically the machine code. Right, so what we will basically each byte will represent one instruction. So what we will insert is this piece of machine code. We will insert this. This is a machine code corresponding to the CPP program for opening a shell. So what we will insert this part into the buffer. Okay. Right, so this is how, in this case, we show an example of a heap overflow. So we try to insert this program into the heap. Heap is where we store the dynamic variable. Right, we insert the heap, and again, we will change some address so that we can execute this malicious code. So this is the original program. So the original program is very simple. So basically, you define structure. Right, the structure contains a buffer, and also a pointer. So this pointer is pointing to the address of the program that will be executed. So in the main function, basically we just get user input, then we allocate the buffer, and then we basically will call a function. The function that will be called is this function. This function just displays the length of the buffer. Okay, that means basically, you put the input into this buffer, and then you use this function to check the length of the input. So that's a very simple program, right? So basically here, you assign the, you declare this structure, and then you assign the function, the address of this function to the second variable here, and then you assign the user input into the buffer, right? So the user input will be put in the buffer, and then the address of this function will be put in the second variable here. Right, so then the program will run this program by calling this process, right? Because the process is pointing to this, you can see here, the process is pointing to this function. So after you get user input, you run this process, right, by calling this function. So you will basically run this process, and then the process essentially will just display the size of buffer. So that's the very simple piece of code, right? You insert something to a buffer, and then you call a function to show the length of the buffer. However, so if the attacker actually can overflow this heap, then actually the attacker can perform something malicious. So this is how it works. So this is actually, this example is from a textbook. So basically, you can see here, this piece of code is exactly the same code we generated, right? So this is basically the code here. So this piece of code actually will be You can see now we will try to insert this piece of code into the buffer. And there is a special string at the beginning. So I will explain this string later. So essentially, you will use this malicious like a machine code to fill the buffer. So basically, you put this content into the buffer. So here, this this command is to this edge here is to tell the system that this should be treated as hexadecimal instead of a character array. So this will be treated as a hexadecimal and then written into the buffer, right? And then this is the address that will be executed. Basically, this address is the address stored here. That means the address for the function that will be executed. Originally, the address should be the address of this function. That means that when you call that, when you use that address, this function will be executed. But now in this program, actually this address now is changed to the address of this machine code. So this is a malicious code. Basically, the original address for showing the length, the function, is now changed to a new address, which is the address of this malicious code. So once you finish this kind of setting, then if you run the program, so basically the program now will execute the command, the instruction at this address. So this address is pointing to the malicious code. Basically now the function, the program will open a shell, right? So the program just open a shell, and then you can basically give some inputs for the shell. For example, if you give who am I, it will print who is the user, it will show it is the root user. Because the program actually is owned by the root user. So in this case, you actually get the permission of the root user. Then if you try to display the content of shadow file, then you can find the content of all the content in the shadow file. So in this case, actually, we change the address here. We change the input of the buffer by putting the malicious code inside and change this address to the address of the malicious code. So originally, this address is assigned to the address of this function. But now we change, overwrite the address to the address of the malicious code. Then in this case, the malicious code will be wrong instead of this original function to display the length of the input. So in this case, then you will open shell because this code is to open shell. And then you will have the permission of the owner of this program. So the program actually is owned by the root user. Then you can see all the content in the shadow file because you have the root permission, right? So this is an example to illustrate how you can use shell code basically to gain control of the machine, right? Okay, so then one question is how do you know this is address, right? So actually this is not a straightforward task to find the address. So essentially what you need to do is you need to use some other tool, because now we don't print a stack or heap. So you need to use some other tool to find the address. So one tool you can use is a debug function. So if say you find a way to crash the system and you run the debugger, then actually you can see you can find some information about the memory of the program. So you will be able to locate. In this case, you will be locate, for example, where the buffer is and where what address I should put here. And here actually, why we put a special string like this? This string, this 90 basically represents a special instruction. It means no operation. So it's like a dummy operation. So if the CPU gets this 90, so it performs no operation. However, so in this case, if we put a string of this no operation here, that means this address actually does not need to be specific, does not need to be the starting address of this machine code. So it can be anywhere here, because say if this address is set to this position, then the program will perform like a no operation. So it will just go through all the no operation, and it will start the malicious code. So if you put the starting position here, the address here, it will again run a few operations, 90, the no operation, right? So you just do some dummy operation, then you will again start the malicious code. So in this case, for this address as files as this address falls in the range here, any position here, then actually the malicious code will be executed. So in this case, you don't need to find the specific address, you just find the range of the address, then the malicious code can be executed. So this is how we can inject some malicious code into the buffer. In this case, it's a heap. And then you can run the malicious code. So if you want to do like a buffer overflow, you want to use the stack overflow. So actually it can be done in a similar way. Right, so in the textbook, actually there are different examples. So one is the heap overflow, one is the stack overflow. The same like a piece of code, the shell code. You can put the shell code in the stack, in the heap, or in the global variable. So if there are different buffers that can be used to do this kind of attack. Right, so that's this is basically the last slide for buffer overflow, right? So we looked at one example how to use buffer overflow to attack some like a machine. For example, you can gain control of the machine. Okay, so that's the first part. Like we finished just some slides left from the previous class. And the next topic we will look at is the mobile core security. Right? So mobile core means the code that can be run on different platforms. For example, in particular, we will look at the code that will be like executed in like browsers. Right? So because for all the code like HTML, JavaScript, this kind of code, actually they can be executed in different platforms. So, but we are not referring to mobile device security, although this can also be a topic, but mobile core security is not mobile device security, right? So we are in particular interested in the code, in the security of the code that is mobile, not the device. Right, so we will look at some particular issues. So one of them is the cross-site scripting. So this is actually one security issue. Nowadays, it's still a security issue, cross-site scripting. And then we will also look at some other issues. Right, so we will start from so this is basically the definition. So the code that is that can be deployed and run on a wide range of platforms. Okay. So we will start with a very simple, a very basic protocol, the HTTP protocol, right? So this is the protocol where which we use for browsing the internet, right? So of course we use HTTP is a protocol, so we use HTML, right? So later we will see some HTML code as well. So we use HTML to implement the web page, and then we use HTTP HTTP is basically an application layer protocol, so we communicate the web application using HTTP protocol. Okay, so however, so actually when HTTP was first defined and developed, so there is some concept of security, but there is no protection at all. So, for example, you can restrict someone to access web page by requiring a username password, right? So, however, so in HTTP 1.0, so the username password actually will be sent in just in an encoded form. So the encoded form actually is not an encrypted form. So the encoding mechanism used is the so-called Base64. So if you study this 368, you should know this one, right? So you try to encode every character into a different character, so a printable ASCII character. So, for example, if you have this username password, then it will be encoded into this format. And then this one will be delivered through the HTTP protocol, and then the web server will decode this string back into the original format, and then we'll check the username password, okay? Right, so the problem here is encoding is not encryption, as I said. So if actually people know, all the people know we use Base64. That means You can, if you, you can like eavesdrop the communication, you can intercept the message, you can always decode this back to the original string. So anyone can do that. That means essentially you are sending username password in clear text. Same as the original FTP protocol. FTP is the same. So although like anonymous FTP, you can directly connect, but some FTP may also require username password, but the username password actually is also sent in clear text. Right, so in this case, say if you have like a web page, so if someone actually can like intercept or eavesdrop the communication, then the person actually can get the password. Right, so this is basically the situation when we had the first like protocol for this version of the HTTP protocol. Right, so. Actually, other protocols will had a similar situation, like FTP. So later, actually, we can use secure FTP to protect. And email, actually, originally email, also there is no security at all. So later, we can have the PGP, SMI. So actually, security always was ignored at the beginning. So, and later, people realized security must be addressed, then we use some like either plugins or new versions to address the security issues. Anyway, so this is basically the, later we will see how basically this can be addressed. So there are some new versions. So some are based on password. So some still use username password, but now we don't send the password in clear text. We use like a hashed password. And then nowadays actually in the HTTP 2.0, actually there is a mechanism that use a public key cryptography to do the authentication instead of using password. Right, so this is not this is not the only problem. And actually in the HTML, so actually you can also cache, you can cache some information, right? So for example, when you do online shopping, actually there can be some hidden field in the HTML code. So when you pick some item, they will be put in the hidden field. So in this case, actually, you can keep those items even if you like visit other pages, right? So sometimes actually people can also, some people will also use this kind of hidden field to cache the username password, right? So in this case, right? So if the username password is cached in clear text form, then of course, if anyone who can access this HTML page, they can see your username password. And a similar issue is when we use a get method, right? So if we use a get method, then actually when you try to do the login, you will send the username password as a parameter, right? So in this case, if you send the username password in clear text, again, people will be able to see the content of your username password. Right, so the security issue behind this hidden field or the get method is if the basically the, for example, the cached web page or cached all the URL locked by the server, they are not well protected, then actually all this content, username, password, are in clear text in the plain text form. So anyone who can access those documents will be able to obtain your username password. So this is another issue for the for the HTTP and HTML related applications, right? So for the authentication later, actually we developed some improved mechanism. So we call it HTTP digest access authentication, right? So if you, for example, if you configure Apache server, so actually you have one option is to use this HTTP digest access authentication. So in this case, we try to improve the authentication. So we don't send the username password in clear text. We try to use a hash function, but we do not simply hash the password. So you don't simply hash the username password and send the hash value. We use a so-called challenge response. So this mechanism is used a lot in 368. So challenge response, that means when you try to access the web page or web server, which is protected, so then you need to pass a response. So the server will send you a challenge, you will need to generate a response. So the response is generated based on password, but the process is not as simple as just hashing the password. So basically you need to hash your username password, and then also the domain you want to visit. So this will be the first hash value. Second hash value is where you the URI you want to access. This will be and also the method you want to access. You want to use get or post, for example. So this will be hashed as the second hash value. Then these two hash values will be hashed again with the other values. For example, the nonce is the challenge from server. So this is you can treat this as a random number that will never repeat. So, and then you also have other content. For example, the client nonce, and also the sequence number. So there is a sequence number included inside the hash. So all this information will be hashed again to produce a response. Right, so if we look at the example from this standard, so IFC 2617 is the document which specifies this particular method. Right, so in the document there is an example. So in the example, for example, this is basically what the server will generate. Right, so this is domain. This is some options for authentication, and then you can send a large random number as a challenge. And the response will be generated based on username, password, right? And also the domain, like the client nonce, this is server nonce, and then the URI, which page you want to visit, and the authentication method, and so on. So the response will be this value. So the details of the process are shown in this slide. So you first basically hash the username, password, and the domain, user, domain, and the password. You get one hash value. Then you hash the method, whether you use get or post, and then the URI you want to visit. This is the second hash. Then you combine these two hash together with the nonce, sequence number, authentication method, and so on. Then you get the last, the final hash value. This is the final hash that will be sent to the server. Server will verify this response. So now basically the process is very complex, looks very complex, right? So we hash many contents together, including the username password. And so now we don't, in this approach, we don't send the password in clear text. We send some hash value. And also, actually the attacker cannot replay any previous hash value because the server will always send a new nonce. Right, so this large number here is a nonce sent by the server. Server will always send a new nonce. That means you need to generate a new response even if you have the same password. Right, so this is basically some standard method to prevent replay attack. So replay attack means if say you simply have sent the first one, say if you simply send this one as the hash of the username password, then someone actually can replace this one later. So they can just capture this hash value, then later they can resend this value to pass authentication. But now if say you have a server challenge the nonce sent by the server, and the nonce is different every time, then basically you cannot replay an old a hash value, because the hash value, the final hash value, will be different every time. Right, so this is improved version. So we have an improved version which can basically somehow protect the password. So I said somehow because if you look at the way we generate the response, so if someone can get the response, right, and if that person knows all the other information, then they can do a brute force for your password. So actually this protocol is still subject to the password guessing attack. So because the domain, the username, all these may be public, right? So and also this method, the index page you visit. So if the attacker can get anything, everything except the password, then you can do a brute force. You can try all the password one by one to see which one can produce this hash value. So if the password produces this correct hash value, that means you get the right password. So in this case, actually, it's still not strong enough. But in many protocols, actually, this problem, such a problem exists. So even in the Windows, like a remote, like a login. So if say you use you log in to a domain using a username, actually, the one of the protocol used by Windows, like the old standard, is the NTLM, so also covered in 368. So in this case, actually, it's a similar mechanism. So you have a hash password, and then you use hash password to generate a response for a challenge. However, so in this case, you can still brute force the password by using the password guessing attack. So this kind of password-based mechanism, many of them actually are vulnerable to a password guessing attack. So nowadays, actually, we try to address this problem by using public key cryptography. And we propose to, for example, use a digital signature in HTTP 2.0, right? So the details, actually, so-called HTTP origin bound authentication, now is in this new RFC standard, right? So this number is quite big. That means it's quite relatively new, right? So. Yeah, so if you look at some very old standard, for example, email, the original email, HTTP, and so on, the number is very small. That means that it's a very old standard. This one actually is quite new. So in this new version, although this one is still not widely deployed, so maybe in the future. Because nowadays, actually, the certificates are free. So you can apply free certificates through some CAs, right? So you can obtain a certificate for maybe some CA provide 9 months, 10 months, 1 year free certificate. So in this case, you can apply a digital certificate. Then in this case, you can use a public key cryptography, right? So if you haven't studied 361 or 368, then you may not really understand how public key cryptography works. So essentially, we don't need to store any secrets on the server. So you only need to obtain a certificate. You have a secret signing key. You pass the certificate to the server, so the server can verify your public certificate. The certificate is public. So then you can use your secret key to generate a so-called digital signature. And the server can verify your signature using your certificate. Server does not need to store any password or any secret. So in this case, we can eliminate the need of a password table on the server side, right? Also, because the digital signature is much more secure than the password, so you cannot do brute force or password guessing and so on, right? So this is basically some recent development for the HTTP authentication. So we try to improve the hash digest based approach by using public key cryptography. Right, so that's for the authentication. So password actually is some sort of long-term secret. But in web applications, we also sometimes use some short-term authentication credential. So cookie is one of them, right? So the cookie actually, can also be used to store many information, a lot of information. For example, your shopping habit, right? So your preference, you can store them in the cookie. And on the other hand, the cookie can also be used for authentication, right? For example, the so-called session cookie allows you to be authenticated by a server without entering your username password again. So that means for a particular communication session, after you use the username password to log in, then you will receive a session cookie from the server. So this session cookie allows you to authenticate yourself to the server without entering username password again. So this is a short-term pass. So you can present your cookie to authenticate yourself. So in this case, actually, in this case, we can have some similar problem as a hidden field, right? So if you have a hidden field, actually, if you cache your password in the hidden field, then you can also do the authentication using the cached password. But the cookie here is basically different from the hidden field, but the functionality shares some similarity. Although in the cookie, we don't directly put your username password. So it's basically a short-term like a pass for you to pass authentication. But the attacker can sometimes can hijack your cookie, like, so like your session cookie, right? So in this case, the attacker can basically hijack your session and then can basically impersonate the user to the server, right? So the cookie usually have an expiry time. For example, the session cookie actually is only valid for one communication session. So if the session finish, then the cookie will expire. But if the cookie is hijacked by the attacker, then in this case, actually the attacker can still use the cookie to impersonate the user. So in this case, the attacker can can pretend that the session is not finished, so you still use the hijacked session cookie to log in. So in this case, we can also have a problem, right? So like hidden field, like the GET protocol, and then like authentication, like if you send username password for authentication, and then also the cookie. So all these kind of credential, like this kind of authentication mechanism can have a security problem if we like do not protect the this kind of information carefully. And sometimes actually it's difficult to prevent the attacker, because later we will see there are different types of attack actually allows the attacker to steal your information, for example, your session cookie, right? So so one way we can actually, one approach we can use to improve the security is we can do the encryption, for example. Now here we are not doing encoding, because if we do encoding, everyone can do the decoding. We are doing encryption. So encryption means you need to use some key to encrypt the data and decrypt the data. So in this case, so if you want to put some like content, like in the hidden field, if you want to put some content, then you can encrypt the content. And then people will not be able to see the original content, right? So that's some like security issues related to the credentials. So we can have like a long-term credential and a short-term credential and so on. Okay, so the second part we will look at for mobile core security is JavaScript. So JavaScript actually is used widely in web applications. And so this kind of like a scripting language actually is very easy to use, convenient to use. But actually it's convenient for the user, it's also convenient for the attacker. So attacker can also use this kind of scripting language to attack like a user's machine. Right, so we will look at some security issues later when we look at the malicious code. Actually, the JavaScript is another tool that can be used by attacker to create some like a virus or malware to damage the user's machine. Right, so for the JavaScript, so if the attacker or the like someone want to like do some malicious actions on your PC, actually they can do it very easily. You can see the code later. You can see the code actually is very simple. So JavaScript basically will be downloaded onto your local machine. That means that when you visit like a web page which contains JavaScript, the script actually will be downloaded together with the HTML to your local machine. Then nowadays actually by default the JavaScript will be blocked, because the browser basically will block any active content by default. So it will give you a warning saying there is active content in the page. So do you want to enable it or not? Right. So if you enable the active content, so if it's like some malicious JavaScript code, then the code will be executed. Right. So this is one simple example. So you can write a simple JavaScript like this. So for scripting language, actually the syntax is not very rigorous or formal. So actually they are very easy to learn and to write. So in this case, actually it will produce an infinite loop, and then it will always show display an alert. Right, so if you click OK or cancel, then it will show another one, right? So the only way you can kill this page is go to Task Manager, and then you kill the the page, right? And in some browser, actually, it will produce like thousands of alerts simultaneously. So this is one simple example. And then we can also use JavaScript to do something else. For example, so you can, when you have some JavaScript in your web page, when you close the page, it can open several new pages for you, right? So if, say, you visit some like a website which contains malicious content, and then you try to close the page, but it will open maybe 5, 10 new pages for you, right? So in this case, you want to close another one, it will open, again, open many new pages for you. Actually, this can also can be done very easily. So in this case, actually, this is the code, right? So when you close the page, the HTML page, then basically this event will be triggered, then this function will be executed, then it will open two new pages for you. And then you can put any address here. So you can redirect the new page to some new website and so on. So in this case, basically you cannot really close the page. So what you can do again is to go to Task Manager and kill the browser. So to kill all the pages, right? So sometimes actually we can also use some JavaScript to burn the resource. For example, you can use some recursive function, right? So if you use some recursion, because remember, so every time you call functions, you create a new stack. That means you occupy some memory. And then if you use this one, like a Fibonacci sequence, it's a recursive function, right? So in function n, you will call function n minus 1 and function n minus 2. So if you run this one, then basically you will, if someone download this page and open this page, then the machine will consume a lot of resource, like CPU and memory, all right? And another type of attack is a spoofing attack. Basically, we can use JavaScript to display something some content to fool the user, right? So maybe you can create some pop-up window or some like a box to ask the user to enter their username password, or you can change some of the content in the displayed in the page, right? For example, actually they can many items in the web page actually can be manipulated by JavaScript. So here are some examples. For example, when you try to move your mouse like to a particular link, so actually you can see the displayed like URL, right? So actually JavaScript can be used to change the content. So although the link is a malicious link, but when you move your mouse, you will see, oh, this is a valid link. So when you click the link, actually you will go to the malicious website. Then you can also change other fields inside in the browser to basically to fool the user to believe they are maybe entering information or like visiting, they are entering information to a real website or like visiting some like a real website. So in this case, the attacker basically can collect some confidential information from the user. Right, so JavaScript, so that's the client-side language, scripting language. And then we also have a server-side scripting language like a PHP, CGI, Perl, and so on. Right, so Perl is another, so we saw some Perl script in the previous classes. So these are the server-side like scripting language. So basically, this kind of language will generate the web page and then send the web page to the user. So they are very convenient for developers because when the user provides some input, then this scripting language can run some code. For example, they can obtain information from the database or from application server. Then they can generate the web page based on user request and then send this web page to the user. So in this case, it's some sort of a dynamic web page because different user provide different input, then the code will generate different output result based on the input and the for example the data from database or other application. So this is some scripting language that will be executed on the server side instead of the client side, right? Okay, so it's very easy to use and it's very fast. So we can have some simple examples. So this one will basically just print the hello world. So to print a web page, print this sentence on the web page. Okay, so this is one. So this is another one. So if you want to print like five lines of code, then you can simply use a for loop. And actually, if you want to print some output, generate some output specific for user request, then of course you can take the user input as for example, user can use the GET protocol or POST protocol to send some input. Then this PHP script will run the program based on user input and then generate the output and send to the user. So in this case, although we only have one page, actually it's dynamic. Based on the user input, you will see different content. Right, so this is a server-side scripting, but of course, if we have server-side scripting language, then attacker may also try to exploit this kind of language to attack the server. So in this case, so the victim becomes a server, right? So because the server is running the code. If the code is malicious, or there is some malicious input injected by the attacker, then the server may leak some like a secret, like a password file and so on, right? So for example, so if say you visit a PHP, like a web page, and you display, originally display a normal page. Say if the user is allowed to change the content, say the normal like index to this one, if the PHP server does not check the user input carefully and display the content here, then obviously the secret information will be leaked, right? So you can also basically, because PHP can also include like a script from other remote sites. So you can set some like a remote set, you can include like a code programs that are like on the remote side, you can include them into the local domain, so in order to run those code. So in this case, say if someone can change the location to a malicious site, then all the script in the malicious site will be loaded by this server, and then of course you again will have some problem, right? So this is a similar problem. So this here in this case, actually, say the path, actually if the attacker can change the content of the path, then originally you want to include, for example, these functions, and the path is some maybe local path, the local directory. But say the attacker can change the path to this one, then when you try to load those code, you are loading the code from a malicious external site. So in this case, the malicious code will be executed on the server instead of the original code, right? So also, so if you like in the PHP, you can use some like a system utility function to like run some like a command. So you can use this one to run some command, or you can use this function to execute some program with some user input. So in this case, if the code, the PHP code contains such kind of functions or instructions, then again, you can give some like malicious input. In this case, the malicious input may let the attacker obtain some information. So this is one example. So this is a web page. So this is a piece of code from like a web page which allow user to send email. So there are several like fields. So in one field, you can specify the sender address. One field, you can specify receiver address. And then there is a form, you can enter the email body. So when you click the send, then the PHP basically will send the email for you, send the email to the receiver, right? However, so if the attacker is malicious, so attacker may try to put a like a receiver address like this. So this is the address of the receiver, the malicious receiver. However, so the receiver also adds something like this. So if say you use this piece of code to and use this as the receiver address, then essentially this file will be attached as a attachment, will be used as an attachment and sent to the receiver, to this bad, to this bad guy, right? So here, basically, if you do not check the input carefully, and you just use such a simple program to send email, then some secret information can be sent to the receiver. So basically here, again, if the input is from the user, then you need to check carefully whether the input is malicious or is like valid. However, so in PHP, actually, there is some utility for you to like prevent some of the attacks. So in particular, in PHP, you have the so-called safe mode. So in safe mode, you can like do some configuration to prevent, for example, illegal access of some file or the execution of some illegal functions. So for example, you can specify if the safe mode is on, so you can specify, for example, in basically, you can specify which directory is the directory that allows users to open and access files. So the user can only access files in that particular directory, right? And then, for example, what are the executables? What is the directory of the executables? So user can only execute the programs in that particular directory, right? So what are the variables the user can change its value? So you can also specify. So user can only change some particular variable, but other variables like the path or some like important variable, the user cannot change its content, right? So if you use these kind of options, then you can prevent some of the attacks. Okay, so that's like a server side scripting language, like a PHP. And the last topic we will look at for mobile code security is this cross-site scripting. So this is still a problem nowadays. So cross-site scripting basically is one of the top like security threats. If you go to some like a security website, actually, if you go to some, there are some websites that will basically list the like vulnerabilities and threats, outstanding threats and vulnerabilities, and cross-site scripting is always among the like top five. Okay, so this one nowadays actually is people already start to basically build technology to prevent this kind of attack. However, so this one actually is quite, I would say, powerful and interesting attack. So originally there was a movie, and I even displayed the movie, I think, just a few weeks ago, but it looks, in the afternoon, it does not work. So actually the movie shows how it works. Essentially, nowadays there are a lot of like forums or like blogs, so you can post content, right? And some actually website, they may allow you to post some like special input. For example, you can highlight the text, you can change the font, and so on. So in this case, in such kind of like a web page, actually the user input allows to contain the text, for example, HTML text. Right, you can have like the specific color, the font, and so on. So in this case, so if the website allows user to do that, then basically the website is vulnerable so to the so-called cross-site scripting. Because the user can, of course, the normal user, they will just put some like highlighting or color for their like post. But an attacker may not do that, may not like look at this feature in the normal way. They may try to put some malicious code, like a JavaScript or other script. They can put some tag to embed some code inside. So in this case, if the server does not do any sanitization or like a screening, then if they just store the content in the, say, the database, later someone try to visit that web page, try to read the post. So in this example, in the first movie, actually it's a car sale website. So someone can post the message, say, I want to sell my car, and then you can give some highlighting and so on. So actually the attacker can put some malicious like script inside the post. And the post will be saved on the server side. So when someone tries to read your like post, then they will download the content. But now the content is downloaded, and then the browser will treat this as some script. Then it will execute the script, right? So in this case, for example, you use JavaScript or VB script, then the script will steal your user information or delete your files or like perform some malicious actions, right? So in the movie, actually, the script will steal the user cookie. Basically, when the user log into the Casio website and try to browse some post, then actually the code, malicious code, will be downloaded. Now it's no longer treated as text, it's treated as a script code. Then the code will be wrong, and then the code will steal the session cookie of the user and send to the attacker. So now basically the attacker gets the session cookie, the attacker can hijack the session and then impersonate the user. So the attacker basically can, for example, look at the credit card information, phone number, address, like, so all those kind of information now can be accessed by the attacker because the attacker hijacked the session. Right, so that's how one typical scenario how this cross-site scripting can be used. And for the attacker, it's quite easy to identify whether there is a vulnerability inside the website or not. Right, so they can simply do some testing. They can try to post something and see whether it works or not. However, so to defend this kind of attack actually is not easy because there are different ways for the attacker to bypass. Even the server perform like a sanitization or screening, filtering, so attacker will find different way to bypass those kind of mechanism, right? So it's easy for the attacker to identify the vulnerability and perform the attack. But on the other hand, actually the damage caused by cross-site scripting can be quite serious. So they can steal your like cookies, or they can like delete your files, or they can redirect your web page to a fake website or phishing website and so on. So in this case, actually the damage caused to the user can be serious. Right, so basically the common tools used by the attacker for this cross-site scripting, so these are again the scripting language like JavaScript, VBScript, ActiveX, and so on. Okay, so this is basically some information about cross-site scripting, and the story, the scenario I mentioned is this so-called persistent accesses. That means that the malicious code will be stored by the web server. And anyone who browses this post, this page, will have the malicious code executed, right? And then there are some different versions. Another version is called the reflective cross-site scripting. So in this case, the script is not stored on the server. Right, so the previous case, the script is stored on server. In this case, the script is reflected by the server. Right, so we also have a scenario like this is from the Wikipedia. So basically, in this case, the attacker will send some like a phishing email or like fake email to the victim. So inside the email, there will be some link. Right, so in this case, actually, the link is a real link. The link is a real link pointing to the real website. However, so inside the link, there is some also malicious content embedded. So in this case, when the user clicks this link, so the content will be sent by the server, but depending on which server the user is accessing. So some server actually will reflect, will bounce back the input. For example, if you do a search, or you do some like a query, or so, for like you for many like a web service, so if you give some input, actually the web server will reflect back the input. For example, when you search something, it will display what you just searched. So in this case, if the malicious content is sent to the server and then bounced back, then again this will cause a problem because now the malicious code is bounced back, right? So in particular, if you search like in Google, you search something, then what you searched will be displayed on the web page, right? So if this is some malicious code, and then this malicious code is like the search content, the user search input. Then you send to the server, server responds back, and then we display this content in your web page. But now actually, the content is some malicious code. Now malicious code will execute again. So this is how the reflective cross-site scripting works. So it will use some web service that will bounce back the user input and display in the user page, user web page. So in this case, so if the content is malicious, so like some script, malicious script, then the malicious script will be executed in the web page. And then the last type, actually there are three types. The last type is the local cross-site scripting. So in this case, there is no server involved. So again, the attacker will send some like a link, and then when the user clicks the link, actually the user now basically will the link is pointing to some other local content, maybe some malicious content, malicious page or vulnerable page in the local machine of the user. So in this case, actually there is no server involved. So when you click the link, actually you activate some malicious content in the local machine. So in this case, we call it local cross-site scripting. So it's different from the previous two cases. In the previous two cases, actually there is a server involved, but this one actually we don't have any server involved. Okay. So how to protect? Then one way is of course to do the filtering, because if say you have some JavaScript included, then you have a JavaScript tag, right? So the tag will say this is a JavaScript. So you can just do some search. Say if the user input, the post given by the user contains a JavaScript, this keyword, then I will just remove, I drop this post, right? However, so it's not as, so to prevent this kind of cross-site scripting is not as simple what I just mentioned. So the reason is actually the attacker can do can use some trick to bypass the filtering. So in particular, if you go to this website, actually this is one of the well-known website which actually shows some current like outstanding security threats and so on. So they also have a so-called cheat sheet. So this cheat sheet will allow, basically displays all the method used by the attacker to escape the filtering. So for example, this is actually, this one is quite old. So maybe it's no longer there, because I think once people identify, attacker can escape the filtering. Using this method, they will try to find some way to prevent it. So in this example, this is an old example. So if say you just use JavaScript to do the filtering, actually I can encode this A by using a different encoding method. So in this case, so if you search JavaScript, then you will not find this keyword. However, when this content is loaded by the user's like browser, then this will still be treated as JavaScript and then still be executed. So in this case, actually we can bypass the filtering. So the attacker can bypass the filtering. So if you are interested, you can look at now what are the outstanding or active method to bypass the filtering for cross-site scripting. And on the other hand, so the encoding is used by the attacker. So on the other hand, actually we can also use encoding to prevent the cross-site scripting. So in particular, Microsoft, they also have a library to do this anti cross-site scripting. So the idea behind this method is to do the encoding for the input. So in this case, now basically we encode everything except some very basic characters. So basically we don't encode A to Z, 0 to 9, and some space, comma, period, but all the other characters now we will encode. So when the user inputs some special character, we always encode those special characters. So later when the encoded content is sent to the browser, the browser basically will do the decoding However, the browser will treat the decoded output as a string, as a text, not as a command, right? So in this case, for example, if you have something like this, then all these special symbols, this one, this one, this one, this one, they will all be encoded, like the even the bracket, all will be encoded. And then, basically, when we try to display the content, we will decode this string back into a text string, text format, and then you just display the text in the screen, on the screen, instead of treating this as a command. So that's basically how we can also use encoding to prevent the cross-site scripting, right? So, and one like a typical example is a Microsoft Anti-XS library. So this library actually will do the encoding. So we can encode like a HTML, JavaScript, BBScript. So all these kind of all these kind of content can be encoded. Okay, so that's for the mobile code security, right? So we finished the topic, and then the last topic will be malicious code. Like we will look at some. I think all the users, all the like computer users, they are familiar with malicious code because I think most of us, almost I think all the computer users, they will meet like a virus, Trojan horse, or even like some spyware and so on. So all these kind of code are so-called malicious code, right? So maybe we have a break, we have a 10 minutes break, then we will look at the malicious code.